It's great to travel. It's great.
We're looking forward to no restrictions.
After being in lockdown for over a year, many Americans are looking forward to a summer somewhere else, and the sky's the limit.
We're expecting a lot of people to be traveling.
With more people getting the COVID vaccine, will crowds come rolling back into Seattle too?
Opening up is huge.
What should you consider before hitting the road?
Just keep an eye on those restrictions.
Our panel of experts weighs in.
We're on a glide path to normalcy right now.
We're in the land of Mozart. It's Salzburg.
COVID considerations as you make your summer travel plans. Next on City Inside Out. Welcome to this edition of City Inside Out. I'm your host, Brian Callinan. After 14 months of pandemic lockdown, all signs are pointing to a busy summer travel season ahead. What's the safest way to make that happen? And what restrictions should you consider before taking a road trip or getting that plane ticket? This week, we're looking at the do's and don'ts of traveling as we emerge from the COVID pandemic this summer. Experts call it revenge travel. An overload of passengers ready to move now that COVID restrictions are starting to ease up.
I'm hoping that we get to a point where people chill out a little bit.
Travelers like Fawn Meyer are anxious about the growing crowds. And SeaTac International Airport Managing Director Lance Little is working on some answers.
You might see longer lines, but it doesn't necessarily mean longer wait.
Even as COVID protocols change in states across the U.S., planes and airports still have a mask mandate. And you'll see increased cleaning, plus socially distant seating in the terminals and restaurants. Little says air traffic at the newly rebranded SEA Airport, down 61% last year, will end up being 30% down in 2021. But for the next few months,
during the summer peak period, it's probably going to look very similar to summer in the pre-pandemic years.
The CDC recommends delaying trips until you're vaccinated. And for international destinations, you're advised to get a COVID test 3 to 5 days after travel. To get to your flight quickly, try out SpotSaver, a pilot program where you can scan a QR code and reserve a place in line at security checkpoints 2 and 5, even before you reach the airport.
So you don't have to stand in line. You wait until you're a page, and it's your time to come in line.
Lines are no fun at the airport. But Tom Norwalk of Visit Seattle would love to see them downtown after a rough 2020 for tourism.
So we went from an $8 billion industry down to just about $4 billion, a little less than $4 billion.
Norwalk says the number of overnight guests in Seattle decreased by 60% last year. And cruise lines were decimated too. But Visit Seattle says new guidance from the CDC and help from the U.S. Senate could get boats back on the water by August. Plus,
our state will be able to lift the vast majority of restrictions on our business activity on June 30th this year.
Governor Jay Inslee's plan to end economic COVID restrictions in Washington by the end of June has provided new hope following 163 downtown Seattle shops closing permanently since last March.
Opening up is huge, not only emotionally for all of us, but for business owners that have been hanging by a thread. It's what we need right now.
The Seattle Convention Center has 18 events on the books right now, and its nearly $2 billion expansion project is set to open in spring of 2022. Visit Seattle is working with a city task force to plan some large events for mid-July and September of this year in an effort to revitalize the downtown core.
And we'll have to be ready because we've all been dreaming and hoping for this for 14 months.
And some travelers are bringing some new hope to our roadways, too.
For this episode, we put together a mini day trip.
Anthony and Marley Love are the couple behind the online show Traveling While Black in Seattle.
It's not to go seek and search racism. It's really to encourage, like, black travel.
The show stayed mostly local in 2020, like many of us dealing with COVID.
Optimism practices extra safety measures.
But this year, Anthony and Marley are planning to be on the road with 37 million people nationwide, according to AAA. a 60% bump from last year.
I'm excited for the summer, honestly. I now that the state is opening up, I feel like we can do a few other things, like more overnight trips.
But they're taking those trips with caution.
But we still got in a good enough workout.
Travel, but travel safely, of course. If you feel uncomfortable, wear your mask. Still.
It was time to hit the Tiger Mountain for a hike.
Just appreciate that freedom again. That's my big advice.
So keep a mask handy along with some patience as we try to emerge from the COVID pandemic during a summer travel season that has a lot of travelers flying high.
Everyone is traveling, so, you know, this whole year we've been down and out, but now we're ready to go. So, hey, we're doing it.
And joining us to talk about this issue, we have with us Rick Steves, the one and only Rick Steves, travel guru, writer, and host. We thank you for being with us. And the one and only John Milbrath. He is vice president of travel products and services from AAA of Washington. Thank you both for being here. Rick, I want to start with you. You have dedicated your career, so much of your life, to traveling. I need to ask, what have you been doing for the last 14 months to start with? And are you feeling comfortable to start traveling again this summer?
Well, I've got 100 people on my staff here at Rick Steves Europe in Edmonds, and we've had no revenue for the last year. So it's a tough time for anybody in tourism these days. I've been just basically laying low. We're keeping our staff together. That's very important to me. We're investing in parts of our program that'll have value when we come out of COVID. We're helping out in our community with volunteer programs and so on. And I've been taking this as kind of a sabbatical. I'm a sort of a workaholic, and this has been God's way of telling me to slow down. It's kind of therapy for a workaholic. And I've been doing things not related to travel, just kind of employing my traveler's mindset right here at home. And I've been enjoying that. Having said that, we're very excited about being able to throttle up and get our program going again. And I've been really pushing people to be patient, to take care of our community, to make sure we're all vaccinated and that we're safe and healthy, and then we will travel again. So okay. My mission is not to get everybody over there ahead of the crowds. My mission is to be patient and to be diligent, and we will travel when the time has come. We're on a glide path to normalcy right now, and we just don't know if it's going to be later in this year or early next year, but we're pretty convinced that we will be back to traveling. Of course, my beat is Europe, and yeah, we fully expect to be doing our tours again in early 2022.
Okay, thank you for that. John, I'll go to you here. Overall, it does appear that people are feeling more confident about traveling as the COVID vaccine gets distributed. What's AAA telling people about the best way to travel this summer? If you could give us kind of an overview to start.
Yeah, I think we've been seeing people, you know, getting in back into travel since the beginning of the year. I mean, really since the vaccine started. And it's working out in kind of concentric circles. And people are doing small road trips. And you know, that's one of the things AAA is involved in. We'll do hotels. We can, you know, get you set up that way. And they're going a little bit further afield. And now they're hitting some of the Western national parks. And they're going to a few warmer places. But people are still, you know, they're still hesitant. And we're recommending that, you know, that people still approach this cautiously, understand the rules, work with, you know, travel advisors to help you understand what you're getting into and make sure that, you know, you assess your own sort of risk tolerance. And everyone's going to, you know, sort of approach this from a different standpoint. But I think it's, you know, people, there's pent up demand. If people are excited to travel, they want to travel. Travel is not going away. It is definitely here and coming back slowly. And I think Rick's point about a glide path, I think that's exactly what we're all on.
Yeah, yeah.
And
we'll see.
John,
if I could mention,
I was just talking to our publisher, and we sell road tripping books, or they sell road tripping books, and they sell my books to Europe. Normally, my books to Europe kind of help subsidize all the road tripping books in our publisher's house. Yeah. But right now, my books are doing nothing, and the only books that are selling are road tripping around the United States. So the services of AAA are huge, especially right now.
Thank you. We've never seen more Atlas sales and more, you know, more of that sale for local trips. People are just they're on it, and they want, you know, they want to go somewhere, and road trips are a relatively safe way to do it. You know who's in your car, you can pick your stops. All of that is helpful on road trips.
And yeah, conversely, it's the Parisians that are enjoying the French Riviera right now, and the Romans exactly. that are enjoying the Tuscan hill towns, and the Seattleites that are going up into the mountains. So that's great.
Yeah. Just real quick, John, in talking about this, I know gas prices are heading up or whatever else. Is it kind of open season on the roads, or how are you presenting it to people? Because I know there's different restrictions in different states, too, that people have to be concerned about.
Yeah, it's interesting. Early on in the pandemic, AAA put together our COVID-19 restrictions map. And so you can actually go on AAA.com and you can understand where the restrictions differ, how they differ, even as things start to change now through the, you know, through some of the new guidelines that are out. So that's a helpful tool. You know, people really, like I said, are starting out slow. I mean, they're taking, you know, relatively, you know, local trips in, you know, kind of in Oregon, Washington, and starting to expand out. I think that's, you know, that's important to just keep an eye on those restrictions. We think, and what we're seeing is people more and more are hitting the road. Gas prices are going to be a small, you know, a small element of all of this. When we go back and we track these numbers all the time at AAA, gas prices really are kind of on pace with where they would have been pre-COVID. So there's nothing totally extreme and outlandish about where we are. It's just we had a significant dip last year as a result of you know, the downturn and complete, you know, change in demand. So we're really in a good place, and we don't anticipate gas prices will affect local travel that much.
Got it. Rick, I want to try to take it on a global scale if I could here. It's been interesting to see Italy is reopening with some COVID-tested flights on Delta. And then you have several other countries with their own rules and their own quarantines. Are you feeling the push from people who want to go on tour saying, hey, can you sort this out for us? We really want to go to Europe right away. There's a lot of different rules between different countries to try to think about here.
Yeah, I just got off of an all-staff meeting with my 100 staffers right here this morning. And I said, we are not going to Europe until all of Europe is open. Right now, you can go to Cyprus, you can go to Greece, you can go to Iceland. I don't care. I'm just not, I mean, we have a landing spot on our website that helps you go with that. But I'm just saying, hang tight. You know, patience is not an American forte. It's certainly not a Rick Steves forte. But right now, patience is my middle name. I'd say this is the year for AAA's triptychs and road trips. And you can all go to Europe next year. If you're hell-bent on going to Europe this year, you can. But I don't fly all the way to Amsterdam to sit in a bubble and not get somebody's germs. I go to Paris to get my cheeks kissed. And I go to Rome to crowd into the piazzas with that gelato and do the passeggiata. And I go to those pubs in Ireland to clink glasses with people who really believe that strangers are just friends we've yet to meet. And that will come. But I'm not going to Europe until then. So every, you know, we have this little news brief that we send to our staff. And, oh, this is happening here. And the Louvre is open. And they're doing this in Lisbon. And I just don't have the patience for that. Yeah. I'm going to wait and go to Europe when the time is right. And that'll be here. But it's a few months later. And if you want to be the first one out of the gate, good for you. But there'll be individual travelers first. But my whole business, or most of my business, is taking bus tours around Europe.
Yeah.
And we're not going to put people through the anxiety and the disappointment of a false start. We're going to wait until Europe is essentially fully opened. And we are very confident that'll be early next year. We're hoping it'll be this fall. And if it is, we'll be selling tours. But we're really going to take deposits starting in 2 weeks for February 2022.
Okay. John, I want to head back to you and talk about SeaTac International Airport here, now known as SEA, already seeing a bump up in crowds, and the airport itself could actually present a different challenge for travelers. So SEA is working on some new options like SpotSaver, this new QR code system, help people save time in the security line. But we're going to see some socially distanced long lines this summer at the airport, no doubt. I want to try to talk about advice for travelers trying to figure out the airport for what might be the first time in a little more than a year. I think it's going to look a little different.
Yeah, it absolutely is. And we've had an opportunity to, you know, to go out and you know, visit the airport and see the procedures and processes they have in place. And they're doing, you know, yeoman's work to make it happen out at the airport and really push the crowds through as best they can. I think to Rick's earlier point about Europe, there are going to be some people that are going to want to go, right? And as soon as it opens up, they're going to go. But it's going to be very different. And just like the airport, right, the airport procedures are going to be different. So allow yourself time. Figure out if there's ways to keep the touch points, and literally the touch points in the airport to a minimum, right? So you're doing your online check-in. Maybe you're parking at the airport so that you're not taking the bus from a further out location. I mean, just plan and be thoughtful about the exposure that you have as you go and do that. I know a lot of people are talking about nonstop flights, so they don't have additional layovers in a particular place. So there are going to be more and more of those sort of procedural changes. And they really are doing a nice job. The airport is, you know, absolutely as clean as it can be. I know the airlines are doing their best to do the same thing. Vaccination. I mean, you know, let's get the risk down to an absolute bare minimum. And I think that's going to help everyone.
Well,
Fair enough. Rick, I want to make sure I send it to you here. I have subscribed to your advice of pack light and carry it on for all the years that I've gone on an airplane. Mm-hmm. And I know you've helped people for years when it comes to navigating European airports. But I think about this. I think we're going to have some issues on both sides of the Atlantic this year. I want to try to talk about people traveling by air. This is a trend that's been going on over the last couple of years, this touchless thing that John was talking about here, that phenomenon. What should people be aware of as they're heading to the airport over the next year here?
Being vaccinated, period. Yeah. When you're vaccinated, you can touch things. You know, I just think it's vaccination. Like John said, I don't know what the political sensibilities here are, but I don't want anybody on my bus tour who's not vaccinated. Yeah. And the big discussion for us in our company is, can we require that in Europe? In 2019, we took 30,000 people on 1,500 tours. I'd like to say all of our guides, all of our bus drivers, and all of our tour members are vaccinated. I'm not sure if that's legal, but I don't think it'll be an issue because I think Europe's going to require it. Yeah. You know, when I was, people are all uptight about this vaccination passport.
Yes,
this is
right.
My passport. When I was a kid, John probably remembers, we had a yellow international certificate of vaccination. To get into Germany, I had to show this thing because they wanted to know if I had my shots. And it was not a political issue back then. It was just how you traveled. Yeah. This particular certificate of vaccination is 2 years old. I got it for going to Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. Well, now we've got a health concern that's not America to Ethiopia. It's any place to any place. And you need some way to prove that you've been vaccinated. Right. How that will be, I'm not sure. Yeah. But that will open the door for a lot of easy travel.
Yeah. And John, just to follow up on this whole concept of proof of vaccination, a lot of different places are talking about this. The state of Hawaii is considering this for this summer, too. I mentioned, and we've talked about the international locations, too. Regardless of how someone feels about vaccine requirements, they really have been a part of traveling for the past several years here. Is having proof of a COVID vaccination something you would recommend for travelers this year? And if so, how do you do something like that?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. And I think the best that individuals in our area can do is have your card that you got at your vaccination site proving the dates and when you got the vaccine. And that's going to be, critically important going forward. I just think it's going to, it's going to get asked for a lot. And I love Rick's point about the passport. I mean, vaccinations for travel is not a new issue. I mean, this has been going on since travel, since we've had vaccinations, and countries require different things. And I think that's why, again, working with travel advisors who really understand and can direct you down the right road is critically important, because what we're seeing, at least initially, cruise ships are gonna be virtually 100% vaccination requirements. That's where cruise ships are coming down on this. And we're getting news every day about little baby steps that the cruise lines are taking. But one of those is gonna be all vaccinated crew and all vaccinated passengers. And so we are gonna have to get to a way to prove that in a little more universal way. And I think everyone's trying to sort that out right now, because there is not one clear path for how to prove this.
As a matter of fact, Congressman Rick Larson just called me a little while ago, and they're working on it like mad in the government. And it's a learning process right now. How are we going to do this? But that's kind of part of the game. But we're going to come to every country needs it, because tourism is the major employer in so many countries. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to go on a bus tour or a river cruise or into a museum wondering how relaxed can I be. When I'm on vacation, I want to be relaxed. When I go out to dinner, I want to be relaxed. If I'm not relaxed, I'm not going to go to all the trouble. And a big part of that relaxation is the comfort of knowing people around me are vaccinated.
Yeah. John, I just want to make sure I touched on your expertise in the cruise industry here, because there's been a lot going on, this whole idea of where a cruise ship has to stop. Does it have to stop in Canada as it heads up to Alaska? So many cruise lines are concerned about this. Can you tell us any new information on this? I know the U.S. Senate has been working on this to try to make sure that these ships can go through. Anything new on this that you could tell us?
Yeah, I mean, there are daily discussions going on trying to push bills through to allow for these large cruise ships, because this is the huge impact to Alaska. And it's a huge impact here to Seattle, because we're such a huge port for that. And without those big ships being able to make that stop over in Canada, right, we've got to deal with the Canadian issue. I think we're working on that, and hopefully we're getting close to having a resolution there. And there is still some hope, while, you know, somewhat slim, that there will be a late summer Alaska season. You know, talking about, you know, Europe and the communities in Europe and how important, you know, tourism is to those communities. Yeah. It is literally in our backyard. I mean, these small towns in Alaska are absolutely devastated by the fact that these cruise ships didn't come all last year. It's not looking like they're coming this year. We're hoping for a little bit of a holdover. So it's, you know, it is really important to the economies of, you know, of even our own country to have tourism back up and running.
Thank you. And Rick, I wanted to make sure I headed back to you on something here, especially about kids. This is an interesting twist here. You've written about how travel can help children become better citizens of the world. I know you've taken your own kids overseas. What do you have to say to families whose kids are so young they might not be able to get vaccinated this summer? I'm talking about 12 or younger, at least as it stands right now.
You know, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know how to answer that, but I would say travel is, regardless of your age, travel makes you friends with the world. It gives you a better understanding of the other 96% of humanity. And as we come out of this COVID crisis, I think one of the, what I call corona bonuses, is going to be that there's a recognition that the challenges that are confronting us in the future will be new kinds of challenges that require good governance, embracing science, and nations working together. You can't whoop the virus here and have it raging south of the border. It'll just sweep back in. So we are all in this together. And that could be something that we come out of this with a good sensibility. And I think John and I would both be advocates of the notion that when we travel, we broaden our perspective and we bring home the most beautiful souvenir. And that is that understanding of the beauty of the family of nations working together.
Yeah, and good health.
Travel really is the great equalizer, Brian. Yeah. And that's the thing about it. I have never gone on a trip where I haven't come back having at least one life-changing moment, right? That just sticks with you and has an impact on how you go forward in the rest of your life. And travel is an integral part of our lives.
Got it. John, let me jump back to you. I wanted to talk about what's happening locally here in the Seattle area if people do stay home instead of traveling this summer. The governor, of course, says our state will lift the major COVID restrictions on businesses by June 30th, hoping to improve the numbers on vaccinations over that time. About 57% of people over 16 have had at least one shot, wants that closer to 70. It's great to see some stores finally reopening here, but do you have concerns about safety here at home as tourists start to flood back to the Northwest from other areas? What's that going to be like?
Yeah, I think it, you know, it's really the same discussion, right? Whether you're going to Europe or whether you're staying close to home, you know, you have to assess your own risk tolerance. And, you know, do you want to go out into crowded places? I think that's one of the reasons why the Northwest, why our own backyard is so popular, right? We have a lot of wide open spaces. We have a lot of national parks right here in Washington State. When you expand that out to a few other Western states, I mean, we've got incredible national parks to travel to. And that would be, you know, that would be, and where we're seeing customers going is to those locations. So that would be the advice, right? It's if your risk tolerance, you don't want to get exposed to big crowds, probably wouldn't do, you know, big crowded events, but, you know, go have fun in a national park and go see wildlife and have one of those life-changing moments right here in our own backyard.
Yeah. Rick, are you recommending more staycations, more virtual tours like you've been doing over the last couple of weeks? More trumpet concerts off your porch.
I've been getting more media when I'm not traveling than when I do travel, because people are like, "What's the travel guy doing when he can't travel?" Well, I'm traveling right here at home. You know, I just have that woven into my DNA. Yeah. I was walking home the other day and I saw a snail on my neighbor's fence, and all I could think of was escargot. But you know, we'll get traveling again. In fact, I've just produced a two-hour show that's airing on public television all over the country. It'll be June 7th on KCTS 9, and it's called Europe Awaits. And I put together the places that I think are just good for our soul when we get traveling again. Mm. And a lot of that is appreciating nature. And of course, as John said, you can do that right here in our own beautiful backyard. And when we finally get traveling internationally again, wherever we're going to travel, we'll want to go to places that I think are a little more mellow, and we won't be dealing with these massive, you know, Disney type crowds in our future travels as much as connecting with nature, connecting with traditions, and really having quality time. And in a lot of cases, that's in smaller towns. One thing I'm concerned about, and I would imagine John is too, is how many of the little mom and pops and the entrepreneurial ventures will be able to survive this COVID time. It's easy for a big company to survive and even thrive during COVID, but it's the small, you know, business adventures, the little guest houses and cafes and restaurants that carbonate the experience. That's why I love living here. That's why I love going to Europe and going to what I call those backdoor destinations. Yeah. And I'm just hoping and praying that they will be still standing when we come out of this difficult time for them, when they've really had no income.
Yeah, I want that back door to stay open for sure. We need to wrap up here, if I could. Some last words of advice, John, maybe for people who have been having this pent-up need for travel for the past 14 months, but they have some concerns too. Some last thoughts here. I can give you about a minute.
Yeah, I would say, get out and do something, assess your own risk and go, go make some things happen, even locally. Start to plan. We're seeing short end trips happening. We're seeing, out into 22 and 23, people are planning for bigger vacations. They're spending more money on that because there is this pent up demand. There's pent up money. And I think we just need to stay safe. And I guess my parting shot would be vaccinate. I mean, that's going to get us all back. And lastly, I'd say, if you can, if your risk tolerance allows it, you can still go to Alaska, even if it's not on a cruise ship, right? You can fly up there. You could, do your own thing, your own vacation up there, help some of these small towns. Again, it's just devastating to see what's happening to our neighbors up there.
Yeah. Let's get two parting shots so we can be fully vaccinated here. Rick, some final thoughts. I can give you a minute, too.
Oh, thanks. Well, we've lived our lives until now without a big problem like this. Imagine if you were born in 1900, all of the things you'd be dealing with through your lifetime. We've had this one thing that's derailed us for a couple of years. We're going to get back on track. We can do it. I'm right with John. Vaccinate. We got to vaccinate. In the meantime, we've got to look out for our neighbors and make sure people that are struggling right here, who will never see their name on a plane ticket, are doing okay. When you do finally start to travel again, look carefully at the financial fine print. In our tour program, we're making it very easy for people to have no financial risk to book a tour, because there's a lot of in uncertainty in planning far ahead. And we've got to understand that with our clientele. And then just be patient. We're coming back to normalcy, but we got to take it one step at a time. And there's no special award for being first out of the gate. 2022 is going to be a great time for traveling. 2021, well, let's just enjoy right here at home for a little while.
Okay. Thank you both for your input here, and we will be right back.
What are people on social media saying about travel right now? One writes, if you've been vaccinated, you should be able to travel the border. You pose virtually no risk to yourself or to others. Another writes, the new CDC guidance is that one doesn't need to wear a mask if fully vaccinated. That does not mean that mask mandates in public are over. Businesses can and should require them. We'd like to know what you think. Send us an email at contact@seattlechannel.org or find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Coming up next week, the Seattle School District has had more than its share of turmoil this past year, with both the superintendent and a prominent board member quitting. Will new leadership make a difference? We hear from interim superintendent Dr. Brent Jones next time on City Inside Out. I hope you join us.